It's especially welcoming and comforting to me to see so many University of Buffalo alums here, and for us as two SUNY institutions in this community to share and collaborate in an event like this. We're particularly excited today to have one of our own Buffalo State alums back to our campus, and she'll be more formally introduced in a moment, but I just wanted to once again welcome Carolyn Lamm back to campus. As an anthropologist whose area of specialty is the sociology and anthropology of law, who has lived in cultures where they didn't have lawyers, my wife is a lawyer, so I'm used to living with lawyers, but it'll be particularly interesting to hear Carolyn's remarks about the role of attorneys these days. So I want to introduce Lori Bloom. And I have to make one other comment, is that I've only been here 3 months, and I'm working on making sure I don't welcome everybody to my previous institution where I was president. I made that mistake once in an earlier job, and I thought my job was over when the president was sitting there and wondering why I was welcoming this crowd to the wrong institution. But anyway, Ms. Bloom, take it away. Thank you very much.
Good morning again to the UB Gold Group. I would like to again welcome Carolyn Lamm here this morning and all of you as well. The Gold Group, for those of you who don't know, stands for Graduates of the Last Decade, which is a very active arm of the UB Law Alumni Association and a group that I am not a member of. If they have a Graduates of the Last Century, I'm in. In addition to many social and networking events, the Law Alumni Association and the Gold Group present outstanding CLE programs throughout the year that are open to the Western New York legal community, such as today's program. And I have to say on a personal note that this is probably one of the highlights of the CLE season this year. I would also like to thank Jane Armbruster from Buff State for inviting us to partner with them in bringing Ms. Lamm to Buffalo, and so that the entire legal community and academic community has an opportunity to be a part of today's event. As this is a CLE program, I think I saw people signing up to get their credit as they came in, but please also fill out the evaluation sheets that you were given as you came in so that we can get your response and reaction and bring you more programs of such a high caliber. And a couple of people apparently were asking, and I'm sure all of you will be interested to know, that a video of today's presentation will be available on the UB Law School website. So give us a few minutes to get that up afterwards, and then you can go and view it if you want to see anything or share it with your friends. Now on to the main event, as they say. It is my distinct pleasure and honor to be able to introduce our distinguished speaker, Carolyn Lamm, here this morning. Just this past August, about 2 months ago, she completed a very successful year as president of the American Bar Association. The ABA is, in case some of you don't know, the largest voluntary professional association in the world, representing nearly 500,000 members. And Ms. Lamm was only the fourth woman, as I mentioned earlier, to lead the group in its 132-year history and the first from Western New York. As president, Carolyn led the effort to analyze information from the ABA's nationwide hearings on diversity and to publish a Next Steps report with companion podcasts. And Next Steps includes specific recommendations for promoting diversity, racial, ethnic, gender, disability, sexual orientation, and eliminating bias throughout the profession. In addition, she appointed commissions to examine two timely concerns: the impact of the global economic crisis on the legal profession and the ethical issues related to lawyers' use of technology, including online law practices. In her spare time, Carolyn is a partner in international arbitration, litigation, and trade lawyer in the Washington, D.C. office of the global law firm White & Case. Prior to joining White & Case, she was employed by the U.S. Department of Justice under the Attorney General's Program for Honor Law Graduates and served as a trial attorney in the Fraud Section, Civil Division, before obtaining the position of Assistant Director, Commercial Litigation Branch, Civil Division. She was recently named one of Legal Times' Visionaries for 2010, and in 2007, the National Law Journal named her as one of the 50 most influential women in America. Please join me in welcoming Carolyn Lamm.
Thank you, and what a pleasure it is to be back here in Western New York and at Buff State. It's been 40 years, and I don't often admit to being that old. So thank you so much. Thank you to the president and to both presidents for the wonderful introduction, and to all of you for getting up early this morning to discuss what I think to be some very important issues for our profession. And I also, it is a fabulous honor for me to be here. I've spoken all over the world in the past year, and certainly all over the United States, but having grown up in Buffalo, and my family has been in Buffalo for many, many generations, well, some of them newer than others, it's home to me, and it's so special to be back with all of you who get to stay here and live here. I get to visit at holidays, so I'm very pleased to be here and share some of the warmth and the wonderful memories I have of my life here and of college here and high school here, etc. But I guess much has changed and much has stayed the same, but much has changed since I graduated from Buff State and went to the University of Miami for law school. And I've also witnessed over those years since I started practicing in 1973 such tremendous changes in the legal profession. Suffice it to say that, you know, when I started practicing, there were still carbon papers and whiteouts and no computers, to be sure. At Justice, there was a big day when we finally got a big computer in, and you could actually go to it and check and begin to do some legal research. We thought it was extraordinary, and this was some special government thing, but indeed it was our future, and it is very much the future of our profession and the way we all live our lives and practice law. It has, you know, had tremendous impacts on the way we do that. The technological developments have changed and transformed all aspects of our life, and one of the huge changes is the speed and rapidity at which you are expected by your clients to respond, and the speed and rapidity at which you're expected to know the answers. And, you know, gone are the days of a client calling you and sending you some documents by mail so that you think about for a few days what the question is, you look at a few cases, you get the documents in the mail. You don't have any of that leisure anymore. You now receive an email with a few PDFs attached to it, and the client saying, why aren't you giving me a response? It takes tremendous discipline really a good relationship with your client to say, no, you want my thoughts and my analysis, and it's going to take some time. And, you know, 40 years ago, certainly a woman would not be addressing you as the immediate past president of the American Bar. Women have made tremendous advancements, certainly, in those 40 years. The first woman president of the ABA was Roberta Ramo. I helped run her campaign, and she won in 95. But it was a struggle. She ran twice and went through 89 ballots to win. So it is, you know, it's not an easy task, to be sure. There was a very recent study, New Millennium, Same Old Glass Ceiling. it remains, it pervades in very different ways and very subtle ways the practice that women are confronted with. But suffice it to say, we continue to make progress, and that's a very good thing, because I think at the end of the day, the product that our clients receive should be the best we can possibly offer. And that requires the input of the best thinkers of any gender, of any race, of any diversity. And all of us have a responsibility as practitioners to assure that. I think all of the technological developments, though, have caused us to change tremendously the way we practice law, the way we relate to people, the way we deal with our clients. But some of our core values have certainly remained the same in the legal profession. And you know, some of the things that caused us to go into law in the first place as a wonderful profession where we could make truly make a difference in people's lives. And we are, all those in the legal profession, have the ability to profoundly affect people's rights, people's properties, people's lives, by ensuring that they have access to justice and ensuring that our courts decide cases on the basis of the rule of law, and not to be confronted with what's in so many legal systems, corruption. That certainly is not something we tolerate here in the United States. But lawyers with vision and principles can make such a profound difference and really have an opportunity to serve as catalysts for change in our society. And for me, a lawyer that inspired ideals was Atticus Finch in To Kill a Mockingbird. So many years ago, I read it here in one of my English courses, and he stood to defend his client against the racism of a community. Certainly, as a young lawyer, I longed to stand beside Atticus, to fight the fight, to stand for what he stood for, but to win. And that's the difference in between where he came out and where we want to come out in today's world. Certainly, throughout my career, I've been and continue to be inspired by those classical ideals of our profession, and I know that all of you are as you serve your clients daily. And they remain increasingly important in today's world to assure that our system of justice in the United States really remains the best and accessible. We struggle with affordable legal services, and lawyers must continue to have a very central role at all levels of society. And I have a few observations about the role of lawyers today that we really need to safeguard, and then I will tell you about some of the things that the ABA is doing to assess what changes we should make as a result of globalization and technology and the impact on the way we practice law. I think first and foremost, lawyers hold the keys to the justice system, and we must protect it for all. Without our assistance, clients simply can't do it. The ABA had a recent study last year assessing the impact, as part of one of my commissions, assessing the impact of the economic crisis on representation and people's rights. And it's very interesting. It's on the website. You can check it. But they really found, by interviewing judges, the profound effect, number one, many more clients go to court without lawyers. And those that are there without lawyers are about 80% less likely to present the right evidence, to ask the right questions, to get a result that is just in terms of what they are confronted with defending. And in many of these instances, you know that they're defending their homes, they're defending their families who are impacted very adversely by the financial crisis, et cetera. So that lawyers have a very important and fundamental role. We must work to assure access to justice, not only for those who can afford us, but for all. and certainly for the poor and the unpopular. And that takes a special responsibility. We do each have a responsibility to do pro bono work and public interest work. Representing the poor in today's society is an enduring need. We have an 80% justice gap. 80% of the poor, even with our legal services corporation, which is wonderful, are unrepresented. The ABA, one of its big initiatives, every year we have all of the presidents of the state and local bars come into Washington. We all go to the Hill. We lobby hard to get funding, adequate funding for the Legal Services Corporation that pays lawyers on legal services staffs across the country. But even with a funding level of $400 million a year, it's a pittance. They turn away about 20 for every one that they take. They simply can't, with that level of funding, and legal services lawyers are not getting rich on legal services salaries. They are very devoted people, but at the end of the day, there simply isn't the representation. Now, I don't think that even with the pro bono effort by every member of the bar devoting well above the 40 hours a year that is the ABA objective, that we could close the gap. We can't do that with pro bono service. The country really needs to devote more and perhaps in some different ways to assure that people have some representation. In DC, we have a system of kiosks in the courthouse, and you can follow as you're going in as a client, how to fill out the form to get a divorce, how to fill out the form to do something, file an uncontested will or whatever. But we need to, as a profession, think about some additional and creative ways that we can offer something online or otherwise to clients who otherwise would go totally unserved and unrepresented. And all of the people, I think it is simply essential for us to assure that they have adequate access to the justice system. The other thing to keep in mind is our legal profession has had a proud history of standing up for those who are unpopular. And certainly zealous advocacy of the unpopular is also very important to the preservation of our system of justice. Now that means perhaps that the people who are called terrorists deserve a defense. Well, they do. We must, in this system, assure that those that we dislike, perhaps as a people the most, have adequate legal representation. It impacts all of us if they don't. I think lawyers, secondly, must also be vigilant keepers of the Constitution and the rule of law. The phrase equal justice under law is engraved over the entrance of the Supreme Court. And to me, this embodies the essence of the rule of law. This phrase describes a system not only where everyone has access to the law and where the law protects everyone equally, but there is no one above the law or beneath the law. And we must strive to assure that. It's a major challenge for us, certainly in this country and around the world. In my practice, I work all over the world, but having represented and worked in legal systems in Russia and Uzbekistan and Saudi Arabia and Argentina, Indonesia, the Philippines, I've witnessed firsthand the impact of a legal system on a people, on a society, where there is not the rule of law. Personal security is not the same. The corruption tends to be rampant. It undermines investment. It undermines any progress in the society on legitimate terms. So freedom's best protection is a fair justice system, and one in which I think lawyers are the most active because we are the guardians of that justice system. Lawyers are also, and this is a fundamentally important role, are the architects of our future society. We have always been there to provide the legal structure for society and how it functions. We really must serve as catalysts for legal change if, in fact, our system is not doing what it should be doing. As a profession, we must assist in the formation of solutions to some of our most challenging problems, and we deal with them every day, and each of us in our own aspect of practice, whether it's disputes or the environment or climate change, they are all very challenging issues that confront our society. Our responsibility is to ensure that, in fact, the solutions include an approach consistent with the rule of law and in a balanced way for all. I do want to talk a little bit this morning about the changes and the challenges in today's world of running a law practice and representing clients, keeping all of these lofty goals in mind and all of our responsibilities as architects of the legal system. We are all confronted with, you know, an ever-changing world. And for lawyers, law firms, and their clients, the rate at which our world continues to flatten has picked up in the past 10 years and shows no sign of slowing. Practice has truly become more global, without a doubt, and part of it is certainly fueled by and propelled by the technological development that has transformed our lives that I really started with. I communicate and did this way this morning on the way here with clients in Switzerland, clients in Uzbekistan, you know, in the push of a button. And before, that really didn't happen in the same way, and I'm sure that each of you do the same thing. I'm sure that here, of course, trans-border with Canada is truly a way of life in your law practice. The other things that have changed tremendously is, you know, about 25 years ago, few lawyers practiced in firms of more than 100. When I became a partner at White & Case, I was the 64th partner. And today we have 420 and over 2,000 lawyers. I mean, your circumstance of law practice, when things have expanded that exponentially, is entirely different. I think today more than 15% of lawyers in America practice in firms of 2,000 or more. And I know that over 35% practice in firms of 200 or more. The analysis of conflicts in that situation alone is challenging. We have an entire general counsel staff that does nothing but sort through our conflicts. It is breathtaking what has become of law practice. You certainly don't just call down the hall and say, hey, are we representing so-and-so? That's gone are those days, to be sure. Lawyers also are far more mobile. Lawyers move from firm to firm. That, too, brings with it a number of legal and ethical issues in terms of moving practices, moving clients, conflicts, how you insure against conflicts, and yet don't inhibit lawyers' mobility or to practice the way they want to practice law. Many of our clients are global today. And many of our clients' businesses are global. Very few clients in the United States find themselves practicing or, in fact, doing business in one little area. There may be the extraordinary one or two, but that is not the norm. there are also new laws regulating the profession around the world. And these are some of the things that I find most challenging for the United States legal practitioners, because we compete with all of them, we interact with all of them. It is nearly impossible never to have done anything with a lawyer from the UK or perhaps from Australia. And under the Australian legal system now, there is a board of consumers and practitioners and judges that administer the legal profession. Gone are the days when there are only lawyers in a particular state in charge. And lawyers are able to be traded on the stock exchange. They have access to capital markets. They can sell shares in their firms. And in fact, the same transition is going on under the new Legal Services Act in the UK. In the UK, for instance, now lawyers can combine with non-lawyer professionals and share their fees, which makes an incredible difference. And in fact, I think in 2011, they too will be able to be traded on the exchange. They too will now be administered by a board of mixed consumers and lawyers and judges, so that the governance of lawyers around the world is transforming. The access to capital markets to fund their firms and indeed fund their litigation or whatever, you know, has a very significant impact in terms of how U.S. practitioners would compete with them. And one of the things that I'll get to that we're really examining very carefully is, and what is the impact on the independence and objectivity of a lawyer who is now performing and reporting to shareholders who are more interested than perhaps their partners might be in profit, although most partners like to see profitable cases. Many times it's illusory. So in any event, the changes are dramatic in terms of the regulation of the profession around the world, and that's not to be ignored. And like it or not, there are a variety of both bilateral and multilateral international trade agreements that affect the legal services sector. And so there are certain things, certainly under WTO, where the U.S. has made certain commitments in terms of what it will do. Fortunately, it started with what we have in place, the 35 states that have foreign legal consultant rules, which lets foreign lawyers come in to practice their particular law. And it gave commitments going forward. We at the ABA have been very active in trying to ensure that the U.S. does not do anything vis-a-vis the legal services sector unilaterally. We should absolutely ask that other states make changes in their laws to permit U.S. lawyers to offer services in wherever, in India, in China, or whatever. We have a situation now, and I've spent a fair amount of time on this one and met with the heads of the All China Lawyers Association in China, where they've applied to the ABA to accredit a Chinese law school in Xinjiang, and they want to produce U.S. JDs. They're hiring professors from the United States. It's all taught in English. And they want their JDs then to take our bars. And yet, in our law firms in China, in Beijing or Shanghai, they will hire our U.S. lawyers in their firms. But if a Chinese lawyer comes to work with a U.S. firm, they will immediately suspend their license because they don't want U.S. firms practicing Chinese law. So there are many developments in an unequal way that we really need to be very cognizant of going forward. And, you know, I think one of the things that drives home and paints the stark reality of where we find ourselves in an increasingly borderless world is the globalization of our business. In 2009, the U.S. exported $1.57 trillion in goods and services and imported $1.95 trillion in goods and services. And every state exported, I think except Hawaii, exported over $1 billion. So that cross-border work and trade is a very important part of the business of the United States and the business that, to be sure, all of the lawyers related to all of those transactions, some were U.S., some were foreign. They're all working together to get the deals done. And the disputes that arise out of them, of course, require lawyers from a variety of legal disciplines to resolve, including those in the United States. The globalization of the world economy requires all of us as lawyers to be able to do more cross-border and in different legal systems, understanding comparative law, international law, et cetera. So we have, you know, a very different world, and the reality is, no matter where you practice, Wall Street or Main Street, you do confront the issues of working in different legal systems, and all of the things that I've been describing are not irrelevancies no matter where you practice law. As a result, I asked the ABA to create the Commission on Ethics 2020, and that refers to a clear vision. It doesn't refer to we're not getting our work done until 2020. I'm very hopeful that we will get it done in the next 2 to 3 years, and I'm staying with it to ensure that it is done. And it is one of the greatest challenges we have to face. I've asked them to undertake their work to study the impact of the globalization that I've described and the technological change that I've described on our profession and the way we practice law, and to assess it against our existing system of lawyer governance and lawyer ethical requirements, to see what changes we need to make in order for us to compete effectively, of course, as U.S. lawyers, and yet to preserve what are so important to us, our core values as a profession. And in my view, we're guided by three fundamental or core principles: protecting the public, the preservation of core values of the legal profession, and perhaps as importantly, the independence and self-regulating legal profession that is where lawyers can operate independently of external pressures. And in some of the situations I've described, certainly you can see what they would be. So it's a complex analysis. We have a tremendous commission working on it, made up of judges, of regulators, of general counsels, of state bar presidents, of great academics, of good thinkers, really good thinkers in the legal profession. And I tried to bring together the best and the brightest to tackle this, because these are enduring problems that we all have to have the right answers to. They've broken themselves into 8 working groups, and I'll tell you briefly about each one. I'm happy to elaborate if you've got questions, specific questions about it, or I can encourage you to go to the ABA website. It's abanet.org. And just go to Ethics 2020. You'll get there in a flash. You can give them your comments on anything they've done. In fact, they welcome the input from lawyers around the country. And what they've done basically is to define the 8 areas where we think the impact's to be greatest. This year, they will spend analyzing what are some of the solutions, what are some of the things that we need to do as lawyers in terms of providing guidance, ethical guidance, new rules, whatever it is. And then next year we will work on getting it through the House of Delegates, getting it through the various state bars that need to pass any change to implement change in the United States. Because the ABA, when it was founded 132 years ago, was really founded in order to bring a consistent approach for ethics and lawyer regulation in the United States. And in fact, it was founded here in New York, I think Saratoga Springs. And in fact, the ABA has done that, but all it does is make recommendations to the states, and then it is up to the individual states to adapt and implement those recommendations. But we do a lot of the heavy lifting, so to speak, in the ABA, and try to bring along all the state and local bars so that what we have is input from all before we actually articulate any standard. And even then, you find great disparities among the states. The first working group, which is very important, is dealing with many of the things that I've been describing on the implications of new technologies, and looking at things like the use of social media, the use of cloud computing. And a lot of people say, oh, cloud computing, it doesn't relate to me. If you use Google Docs, you're in the cloud. And if there's a breach of confidentiality, what does that do, and who's responsible as a lawyer if someone hacks in as you're using Google Docs? What do you have to do to protect your client's information? That is essential and something that we really need to think through and provide guidance for lawyers going forward. The same with what you post, in terms of emails. How protected do they have to be? What kinds of security systems must a lawyer have to communicate vis-a-vis their evidence, their mental impressions, whatever it is, with their clients on the internet? There really is very little on it in today's regulations other than a very broad-based rule on confidentiality, and you've got an obligation to protect it. Well, what does that mean in today's world? And what is responsible for a lawyer to do? We also have virtual law offices. You know, a lot of small firms and solo practitioners, which make up the bulk of our legal practice in this country, band together in a virtual law firm to deal with a particular problem. Even large firms will band together with experts in certain areas to present a well-rounded service to a client. What does that mean in terms of conflicts? What does that mean in terms of protecting the information and the evidence that you share? So, and if it's cross-border, what does that mean when the rules of professional responsibility differ? I mean, in the EU now, in-house lawyers have no attorney-client privilege as a result of the AXO decision. So when you're dealing with that, and you've got a company with some facilities overseas and general counsels overseas, what does that mean? You'll be advocating to a U.S. court that is still protected, but in the EU, it's not. So we are trying to find ways to reconcile divergent approaches when we've got lawyers operating in both contexts. We have another group on domestic and international outsourcing, another one of the technology-driven innovations, certainly of this century. And we're looking at both whether the existing rules provide sufficient guidance and what we have to do. Now, the New York State Bar has one of the better opinions on outsourcing, but it basically addresses the question of, if you're going to outsource, if you're going to use lawyers in India, because they're much cheaper, they're $20 an hour, not $200 or $400 or whatever, you're going to use lawyers in India to do your document work. Whose responsibility is it if there is an error? Of course, it's yours. But what kind of information do you have to disclose to your client about the fact that you're using them? How much can you add to that fee for you to recover in terms of a profit if you're using them? There are a myriad of issues that come up in using outsourcing as part of the legal service that you're rendering. The other, I've seen from the other end of the telescope, is the clients will go to them and they'll come to you with some joint venture agreement that they've gotten out of India. And they'll say, could you take a few hours and look at this and tell me if it's okay? And what's your responsibility there? You can't obviously look at something in 2 hours and say structurally that it's going to work and that the tax implications are what they say they are and all of the other myriad of things. But I think lawyers need some guidance on that, and clients need guidance. We also have another group on entity regulation and alternative business structures. Well, here in New York, you do regulate law firms. You're one of only two states in the United States that does that, and we're wondering if others should do that. But also alternative business structures. That's what I mentioned, where you've got non-professionals working together with lawyers to deliver a better service. Now, in D.C., we do permit it, and in 13 states of the United States, we do permit that. And, of course, in the U.K. and in the EU, that's permitted, but it's not permitted in many of the other states of the United States, and that is something that continues to be under examination and may well be rejected. I don't know where it will end up, or what happens is the ABA loses its leadership role and the states do what they want to do to implement it if we can't get a uniform principle articulated by the ABA. Alternative litigation financing is another group, and that's a big area. We now find that many lenders in the United States and outside the United States are lending to finance litigation. And sometimes they take a piece of the action, so to speak. They take a percentage of the upside, whatever it is, defense or plaintiffs. And many times they finance just for a fee. Well, the question is, what does that do to a lawyer's independence and objectivity? If you decide to finance, what are the things that you ethically should put in place to assure that what you're doing and the way you're doing it is appropriate? And, what kind of disclosures have to be made, if any, to assure, a level playing field, if you should have one? Perhaps you don't. We have another one, and this is perhaps one of the more complex ones, the group on conflicts of interest, uniformity, and choice of law. I've already described some of the confidentiality issues. Between competing systems, there are a fair amount of differences. Of course, 1.10, the attribution of conflicts within a firm continues to be a challenge. It's not a challenge for a small firm. If you're in a firm of 2 or 4 or 10 lawyers and you all know each other's business, know each other's clients, it's one thing. If you're in a large firm of 2,000, it poses an entirely different problem when you have people who are perhaps partners you'd never see or you see once a year, and the relationship isn't quite as strong. So we are examining, and the UK now has a rule that permits a different approach on some ethical rules between sophisticated and unsophisticated clients and firms. I don't know if that's something we will ever do in the US, but that is certainly under the microscope. We're looking at inbound foreign lawyers questions. There are many who would like to be here. We're looking at, and at the urging of the New York State Bar, the ranking of law firms and lawyers by all of these commercial entities, and looking at it both in terms of what should be done, how it should be done, and of course we struggle with First Amendment rights, and we know there's a Bates decision, there's only so much you can regulate, but you can require disclosure, certainly, of the methodology, if it's pay to play, and what they're doing, what these rankers are doing, how they're doing it, and you can also require and mandate that it is unprofessional conduct for lawyers to say bad things about other lawyers that are totally unjustified just to enhance their own ranking. So we're looking at a lot of those issues in that. So I guess with the quickening pace of change and all that we confront, to be sure, this is a challenging time for the legal profession. We have everything from, Richard Susskind's book on the end of lawyers to everyone who thinks, we're going to wake up and it's going to be like it was. I don't think either is right. I think we're somewhere in between, but all of us live in challenging times, and we all have to move to adjust the way we practice law and the way we look at the way we practice law to assure the best possible service to our clients, to the public, and civil treatment of each other as lawyers. So thank you so very much. It's been great to talk with you. Happy to answer questions if you have any questions. Yes?
Is there, I
Well, the ABA, I don't know that it supports. I don't know that I would characterize what the ABA does as that. There is a new study that the section on legal ed, they had the deans of many law schools come together and study this. And while they condemn U.S. News and World Report, in that report, and it's on the website, you can look at it, they condemn it and the impact that it has on a number of aspects of law school populations, et cetera. They also say, you know, annually the ABA does have forms that it fills out from every law school and provides to the DOE. It's all available on the website. So there's no reason that any student who's interested in making that kind of a decision should be going to the kind of information you find in U.S. News instead of going to the source and actually looking at what the law schools are reporting to the Department of Education via the ABA. And we do promote law students looking at that. We also, on the part of the website from the my commission on the impact of the economic crisis, we have a memo to law students available for them to look at saying, before you incur huge loads of debt, understand that lawyers in America, by and large, don't make the salaries up in the hundreds of thousands. And for you to incur several hundred thousand dollars worth of debt may not be a good idea. And we do lay it out in a memo. It is available to them, but I don't know how else to get it into their hands. It is on our website. Yes? No, we don't, and I'll tell you why. There are about three different answers. One, we have a consent decree against the ABA from the Justice Department for violating the antitrust laws by restricting any kind of admission to law schools and to the profession vis-a-vis state bars. So you can't do anything that's anti-competitive, very obviously. But secondly, I do think when you've got an 80% justice gap, 80% of the poor are unrepresented. Probably in today's world, about 60% of the middle class are unrepresented. It's not a question of demand or supply. It's a question of the economics of who can afford to pay for lawyers to do the representation. What kind of a priority do we put on it as a people so that it should be funded more perhaps publicly to ensure the representation of people in court by lawyers? So we don't have an oversupply of lawyers at all. We have a justice gap. What we have is a gap in who's paying for lawyers. Yes? No, we work, and a huge amount of my time last year and this year is spent collaboratively. We have something that's called the L4, the presidents and president-elects of the four big worldwide bars meet twice a year. That is the IBA, the UIA, the Union Internationale des Avocats, the CCBE, and the ABA. We meet and we confer about, you know, what's going on in terms of lawyer regulation around the world. So we get a lot of information in that regard. We also meet as president of the ABA with the Canadian Bar in the Federation of Canadian Bars. So we know what's going on in Canada. I went to the meeting of the Mexican Bar and know them very well as well. And we keep up with what's going on in terms of lawyer regulation in Mexico. We do, as we have, of course, the ABA has a seat on the governing board of the IBA. And so we attend all their meetings. I was just at the meeting in Vancouver. And we do, keep up, and all of that informs what we do. We go to all of the main meetings of the, for the Law Society in the UK, we go to the opening of the legal year, we go to the same in France, and I just spoke at the CCBE, which is the Conference of European Bars, in September to tell them and update them. It was their big annual meeting on what's going on with Ethics 2020, and I get information from them as well. So a big part of what the president of the ABA does is keep up with all of the various international entities so that we know what's going on, and we can bring that back to the ABA, and it guides us in formulating our policy and approaches. Well, in the ABA, we haven't forgotten that big number. And in fact, that's something that I focused on last year, both in terms of bringing more products to, I think it's about 65% of the people, lawyers in the United States, practice in firms of, five or fewer, and in solo practices. We also, at my urging, the House of Delegates cut the dues in half for solo practitioners because I heard from them that one of the reasons they weren't joining the ABA is because the dues were high. We have increased by 100% our now recruitment since last February when we passed that change of solos. We've got much more online. We're doing a revised website with lots of podcasts available for solos. We're going to have a chat room for solos. So we have, many things to serve the members who are solos. In terms of the transformation into a business, that's a debate as old as the ABA is, whether we are professionals or whether we're engaged in a business. And I've heard each side debated with passion, I must say. I'm firmly convinced that we continue to be a very noble profession, or we wouldn't be concerned about the public, and we wouldn't be concerned about the pro bono work that lawyers do, and we wouldn't be concerned about so many of the things that we are intensely concerned about. I think that it is, to be sure, you have some business aspects of your practice. But that doesn't mean that you serve your clients any less or any less fervently.
From your experiences around the world, have you learned any information or tactics for dealing with the gap in legal services and how to pay for it?
Well, there are many places in the world where much more public funding is devoted to providing legal services to the poor and proposing various things. The ABA is fully committed to and passed a resolution supporting what's called Civil Gideon. If someone is in danger of losing their home, their family, a fundamental human right, we feel that a lawyer should be provided by the state or by the country. And I think that is very important. California, in fact, took the first step in this direction to implement Civil Gideon, which is amazing given their current financial situation. They devoted, although a small amount, $10 million this year to fund lawyers in a Civil Gideon-type context. And I do think we need additional advocacy to ensure that funds are devoted to that, because there is a very significant impact. But some of the things that people are doing around the world, there's much more, I think, community education and helping people learn at a community-based level how to advocate for themselves and perhaps meet with a lawyer and then know what to do a little bit better. The ABA has one big project in the immigration area, and we've in the border states, we have certain centers where the detainees, we have video programs for them to watch in their languages, and we have, video, those are, downloadable, they can watch at their leisure. We also have people that go and instruct them on, okay, here's the deal in the proceeding, you've got to have this, this, and this document, get it, if you don't have it, you're out of here. But we find that, in fact, there's no representation for these people, and just doing that much work with them gives those who should be having more access to a justice system before they're deported really doing far better. I think there is a very significant increase. The ABA, in fact, has a report. It's a 500-page report done pro bono by Arnold and Porter on the immigration adjudication system, and you can see this aspect of it addressed in that, and it's, again, posted on our website. Any other questions? Well, great to talk with you, and great to meet so many of you.
The president of our Law Alumni Association had to leave for a client matter, so she asked me to thank Ms. Lamm for being with us today. Thank you so much. Your presentation was very incredible and very insightful, and we appreciate it. If you are here for CLE, please stop and get your CLE certificate as you leave. They will be available at the tables outside. If you did not sign in, you do need to sign in before you can get your certificate, and we will collect your evaluations as well. Thank you very much for being here today.